Welcome to a discussion about Amazon ElastiCache, a service that's designed to provide real-time application performance because all the data is stored in memory, while also optimizing overall database expenditures. My name is Tom Cooley. I'm Worldwide Go-to-Market Lead for In-Memory Databases, and I'll be kicking it off and then passing it over to Stephen Hance, Senior Specialist Solution Architect, who's going to drill down into the product details, including how it saves you money. Never before has the statement, time is money, been more appropriate than in the era of modern applications. So businesses across all verticals these days are operating more and more online and mobile. They continue to displace the physical world with the digital world, whether it's conducting banking transactions, consuming streaming media, receiving healthcare advice, completing their tax forms, ordering food and groceries. More and more screens are becoming the face of the brand, and when customers have those precious consumers at hand, it's important they have a terrific user experience. It's not limited to just consumer-facing applications. More businesses are gathering data, conducting analytics against that data, deploying machines to process that data. Yet if you have a catastrophic event, for example, on a factory floor, or you detect a security breach, or you detect fraud, it's very important that you respond in real time or near real time to bring value to all that work you're doing with the data. So latency is simply not an option anymore. An unresponsive application causes financial loss because users move on or operations suffer. Indeed, latency is the new outage. And there's a lot of data that supports that claim. For example, one recent study cited the number one reason people abandon a website after viewing just one page is too slow. They're frustrated. So the vast majority will leave, many will purchase from another retailer, and many won't return at all. A famous Akamai study several years ago stated that a 2-second delay in web page load time increased bounce rate by a remarkable 103%. And a customer of ours, a brokerage firm, was losing $20 million in revenue when their trading platform was 5 milliseconds, not seconds, 5 milliseconds behind the competition. That's $4 million in revenue per millisecond. So indeed, time is money. So our customers certainly understand the need for highly performing applications, but they're challenged with the balance of investment because they can't throw endless money at this. And also, this is compounded because the foundational infrastructure is largely based on relational databases. They've been around for decades, fantastic technology, but they weren't designed for a lot of the modern application requirements. They're monolithic in their data structures, they don't accommodate a lot of data types, and they don't accommodate extremely high throughput, like hundreds of millions of transactions per second. So consequently, our customers are often spending a lot of money to increase the performance of their applications, or they're migrating to an entirely new database technology, which requires application refactoring. This is really where caching comes in, because caching modernizes applications through in-memory speed, and it modernizes applications through adding different data structures for application innovation, while simultaneously reducing the overall cost by relieving pressure of the primary data store. So Amazon ElastiCache has been around for about a decade. It's one of the most successful managed caching services focused on the needs for modern applications. It's based on two open source engines, Memcached for simple cache, and by far the most popular, Redis, because of the numerous data structures developers can avail themselves of. It's highly performant and scalable, microsecond read-write response times across hundreds of millions of operations per second, provides secure cross-region replications, we auto-scale clusters, it's highly available, highly secure, we keep that at the forefront of our design principles, with 4.9 SLAs, automatic failovers and recovery, encryption at rest and in transit, and compliant with the major regulatory bodies like HIPAA, PCI, and FedRAMP. Importantly, it's fully managed, open source compatible. We automate all the time-consuming database management tasks like provisioning, patching, and backups, which can become challenging with the caching layer. We efficiently scale in and out by adding shards, primary nodes, and replica nodes, and scaling them back in or up and down our instance types to meet your demands. And it's fully compatible with the open source engines. For example, with Redis, you will have full access to all of the flexible data structures. Before I pass it on to Steven, I just want to summarize. We're not displacing your existing database infrastructure. We're complementing it while driving scalability and performance, decreasing overall database spend, and driving application innovation. Over to you, Steven.
Thank you, Tom. Let's now look at some real-time performance examples, how this might affect an application. So what we had in the past, basically had your applications, whether it was EC2 or Lambda, if you're a more modern application, and you accessed your database. You did your writes and your reads from your database, and life was good. You had your primary database, and if you need to scale it up, you scaled it up. And your writes went there, and your reads came out of there. So every time you scaled your database up, you got more memory, maybe you got more CPU, and some increased network capacity. However, this model does have its limits because there's only so much that you can scale up to. At some point, you're going to have an instance that is the largest instance and you can't get any larger than that. Or it's just not really cost effective. An alternate solution to that was basically something called scaling out, where you add the read replicas to your database. So you can add one or many more read replicas, and this is going to help you with the read throughput. However, this itself has its own drawbacks because, you know, there's a limit, again, how far you could scale out, how many read replicas you could add, and each one of the read replicas replicates the entire data set. So you're replicating a lot of data. In many cases, you just have access to a small fraction of it. So it's not very cost effective. It's slow disk-based replication, and it's definitely not going to be cheap because each one of the read replicas is going to cost you another database license. So these are some of the limitations. If you were to look at this from a different perspective, now that you learn about ElastiCache, we introduce caching service, you would be able to introduce a caching service somewhere in between the client and the database. So this is going to improve your latency by a huge factor because ElastiCache stores all its data in memory only. We'll be able to increase your capacity without changing the database capacity because ElastiCache could scale by itself, just the cache, horizontally and vertically as it's needed. In fact, it could scale even to multiple regions. And it's a fraction of the cost of scaling your database. And this will help you with reducing your database sprawling. So what's going to happen? Basically, you still write to the database as you did before. You do one read from it, and then you update your cache. And subsequent reads will come out from your cache. This is going to help you keep your database at the current size, reduce read load from your database, allow it to do other work without scaling up your database, and gives you a lot of flexibility and options to go through ElastiCache. Now, ElastiCache is extremely fast. We're talking about most of the commands to basically return an answer in a sub-millisecond. However, we know that reading from memory is very fast and very effective, but how does it compare cost-wise? Let me show you a different example. This is more technical, a bit more architectural example. In this case, it's an RDS SQL Server implementation that uses multiple availability zones for high availability or production implementation. And this is actually the reverse of it. Why I say the reverse? In many cases, the databases are scaled to meet the maximum workload demand. Now, you could size a database to a different size, but it usually takes a long time, it's cumbersome, it might affect your current workloads. So in many cases, projects and database administrators, they just bring in the biggest database instance that is going to run the worst case scenario. So if in this case, let's say that's a 2XL and that runs your workload, it's going to cost you about $89,000 a year, two of those across two availability zones. Now, an alternate to this is to introduce ElastiCache. And what that caching service will allow you to do, in this case, is you can scale back your database instance. Instead of being a 2XL, you could scale it down to an XL instance size. You don't have to scale your database for worst case scenario anymore. You have the cache in front of you to do that. So in this case, the end result is pretty much the same. You're still going to have 16 CPUs, about the same amount, actually more memory, more compute, double the network, the same high availability, because ElastiCache does support multi-AZ high availability, and you could realize about 45% cost savings. So either way that you're at the position that you have to scale up, ElastiCache would help you, or you're already running your database, but you realize that you could scale it back by adding caching. Either way, it could be beneficial to your workload. Now let's look at some demos, how this plays out, and look at some actual numbers. So let's look at the at an example to see how it would this play out in real life. For this example, let me show you the architectural diagram, what we're trying to do here. So in this example, we have a MySQL server. You can see it in the middle here. And we have an ElastiCache implemented with the primary and the read replica. And we could have one or many application nodes, in this case our EC2s, that will access, in the first test scenario, will access just the MySQL server. And in scenario two is going to use actual ElastiCache when it's possible, as you've seen it in the demo, try to read from the database first and then store it in ElastiCache, and subsequent reads are going to come out of from ElastiCache. So this is kind of like the architectural diagram. We're going to use one EC2 in this case, but you can have obviously more than one. But for this demo, we're going to use one that's going to access first the database in scenario one, and then the database and ElastiCache. So here's my prompt, and this is going to be scenario one when the all the SQLs are directed strictly to the database. We're going to time the command, and we're going to execute it with 10 parallel threads. That's the first parameter. And the second one is 10,000, that each thread is going to execute 10,000 random queries. Now, these random queries are executing a mediocre or less than mediocre complexity to SQL statement that is actually joining two tables that each have a primary key on it, and is going to retrieve the data on that. Actually, it's using a public schema that is going to be executed this time strictly against the RDS, the MySQL database. It's not going to use ElastiCache. That's called the scenario one. The completion of this test is about 1 minute. We may pause this video to jump over it, but we'll see the result at the end, and I'll explain to you what the numbers mean. All right, thank you. Now that we're back, the command has completed. So it took about 58 seconds to complete, to execute actually 100,000 executions. And there are some numbers here. So in the first second, it executed 979 commands for a total of 5.8 seconds. This is the cumulative time. Obviously, they were executed in parallel. The minimum response time was about 1.7 milliseconds. And the longest, these numbers are in seconds, by the way, and the longest execution was 32 milliseconds during the first second. As it progressed towards the end of it in the last second, because there were not that many commands left, it only executed 71 commands, and it got a little bit faster. And this is our log file. So what we could do, actually, I could copy this log file, and we have a Juniper notebook ready here where we can look and actually analyze and generate graphs out of this log file so we can see how it performed. And as we can see it, the database by itself was able to execute about 1700 and a bit, about 1750 queries per second, which is not bad, I guess, depends, with an average response time of about 5.5-6 milliseconds. That was the average response time. So now let's run the same test. We're going to run the same test, but this time we're going to use scenario two. Now scenario two is going to use ElastiCache for 80% of the work. It will try to use the cache 80% of the time, and 20% of the time is still going to use the database, because no database work, no workload is 100% cacheable. So only 80% of the time is going to use the cache. So it's the same program. It's just going to use a different scenario with the same parameters, 10 threads, 10,000 executions. And let's see how long it takes to execute this. Again, and now is going to use both the database and ElastiCache. We'll try to use as much as possible the ElastiCache, but not 100% of the time. Now, as you can see, the same test completed in less than half the time, completed in 23 seconds. And you can see it in the numbers that in 1 second, it was able to execute 3,800 queries per second in the first second. because of the help of the caching service. And you can look at the times, look at the minimum response time, less than half a millisecond. Very fast, especially when it goes to the cache. Now, when it has to go to the database, some of those outlying numbers are about the same, not much worse. But when it uses the cache, it's less than a millisecond. We're talking about half a millisecond for the command completion and a lot more work. So not only it takes half the time, but it can do sometimes four times as much work. So let's plot these numbers now in our notebook and see how this graphs out. So we can have a different notebook for that, and we're going to put in the same log num information that we retrieved, and we're going to run the cells, all of them. Wow, look at the difference. Instead of about 1700, 1750, we were able to execute about 4200, not quite 45, about 4500 queries per second, significantly faster. And let's see a response time. The response time, again, is less than half the response time. Instead of about 0.5 milliseconds, we're talking about 0.2 milliseconds. So in less than half the time, we were able to execute more than twice the work. So obviously, there's clear advantages of using a caching service. This concludes our presentation for today. If you have any questions, please direct them to Tom or myself, and we'll be glad to follow up with that.